Hey, what about Night to Shine? Anybody still standing after that event the other night? Oh, I told Melissa on the way in, I said, it is hard to come out after looking like this, after that song, it is finished. Or as Dolly Parton said, it takes a lot of money to look this cheap, I'm going to tell you. I'm going to take those off, and I'm going to say hello to everyone in the house, to everyone who is viewing online today. I do not always look like this or dress like this, but we are still in celebration mode. And if you don't know what we're celebrating, we're going to let you know today. In the next week, we're going to jump back into Upside Down Kingdom and Sermon on the Mount. Our mission statement at Northfield, if you don't know it, has always been, from the very beginning, to love God, to love people, and to make Jesus known. And you guys love people well, and I just want to say thank you. Let me give you a couple of stats about the other night. Two countries, 54 community sponsors in addition to our church, 40 honored guests in the Dominican Republic, 178 when the final total came in, honored guests in Gallatin, 681 volunteers between the two countries, thousands of hours, and one amazing, amazing evening. And you guys made that possible. Could I just say thank you? I am looking around. I would love to call all 681 people by name, but I can't. So, you know, every event has its Moses and it has its Joshua, whatever it is. And I see Haley sitting right up here on the front row, a very pregnant Haley. Haley, come on up. She was the staff lead who kind of took the lead over this year. Oh, hey, we want to say thank you. I don't have it up here, but we're going to give you and Trent a night to just go shine somewhere by yourself for a little bit. And hey, what you may not know is that we thought we were having a baby Tuesday, didn't we?
Yes,
we had IVs. We were at the doctor, and the staff was saying, have the baby, we'll be okay. Haley was saying, hold the baby in, I got to be there. Anyway, thank you so very much for everything you did, Haley. Thank you. In fact, I would like to say, if you had a part in Night to Shine at all in any way, would you just stand right now? Look at the army of people that it took to make Night to Shine happen. And then I don't know if we have any right now. I know that there are some in classes in the back. Do we have any honored guests who are in the audience right now? Look here. I don't know you. Oh, right over here. Hey. And right here. Brock, I see you over there. Hey, you hug them when you get around them. Well, I want to say, you know, you guys were the hands and feet of Jesus this weekend. It was absolutely an incredible evening. For those of you who were not able to be here, or for those of you who worked in areas where you didn't get to see the red carpet, or you didn't get to see the prom area, which was inside here, Melissa Lancaster and just an incredible team of videographers and photographers, they captured the evening in a video that we're going to show you in just a second. It's going to become public and shareable after the 11 a.m. service. Let me tell you how you can get that. If you do not subscribe to the Northfield YouTube channel, you need to subscribe to that. If you go to YouTube and you type in NF Church Gallatin, our church will come up. Two things: hit the subscribe button and then hit the little bell icon, and that will give you a notification anytime we release something, or that's what they tell me will happen. Anyway, I may have to get my 7-year-old grandson to show me how to do that. So anyway, that's how you can get it and how you can begin to share it after the 11 a.m. service today. But for now, take a look. If you were here, you're going to enjoy the recap. If you weren't here, you're going to get to see an amazing evening of what went on. Look at the screens with me. Father, we thank you so much for tonight. Father, we thank you for every honored guest that's here. Father, we thank you for every caregiver, for everybody. Father, for everyone who worked with food or dancing or karaoke or the parking lot or flowers or all the hundreds of things that it took to make tonight possible. We thank you for that. We love you. We are in love with you. And Father, we do it for you. And everyone, not just Shine 2023, said,
Amen.
Allow God to work through you, and what incredible things happen when you just open your eyes and your hearts and you say yes. You know, so many things go into an evening like that. To be honest, we were both excited and a little bit nervous. Two different countries and 50 more honored guests on our campus here than what we normally have. And, you know, sometimes all that nervousness and all that angst goes away when the first honored guest walks through the door, and then sometimes when 40 honored guests walk walk through the door 30 minutes ahead of time, that ache comes right back in there. And I see Stacy nodding over there. She was in one of the rooms, kind of the main floor where people were checking in and then doing their hair and makeup. And Lisa Dodson, one of our staff members, said, I looked out there and all of a sudden there was a crowd when we weren't expecting a crowd, and they were there, and my heart was going, okay, what do I need to do? How do I make the calm? How do I make it lighter? How do I kind of disperse people through here? She said, when I heard a mother look at her and say, just look at all these volunteers loving on our kids. And all of a sudden, perspective just kind of changed. And I don't know if you saw the red carpet out there. I want to say a special thank you to all of you, all 300 of you who stood out there for 3 hours in what was a little bit chilly weather and sometimes the breeze going out there. And wow, you did it with excellence. I can't think of his name, but Buddy right here on the front row told me in between services, he says, my first time to be a buddy. And he said, you know, as much as it was encouraging when we got out of the limo for our honored guest, he said, I was overwhelmed myself. He said, not even at any event have I ever been to was the celebration was like that. He said, so as encouraging as it was for them, it was also encouraging on the other end. I want to spend a few minutes this morning because we are in a series on the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus talks about how we treat other people and how we love on other people. I wanted you to hear just a few sights and sounds from the evening. One of our volunteers, a young lady who volunteers every week back here, Lexi Walden, she wrote these words on her Facebook page. If I had to choose one word for Night to Shine 2023, it would be the word grateful. I'm grateful for the opportunity to stand in the background, and I think we had a picture of her up a while ago. Did we have that up there? And she is in the background again over there, right by her dad there, and her sister Laura, who all three just serve incredibly. She said, I'm grateful for the opportunity to stand in the background and capture moments of kings and queens feeling loved and celebrated. Grateful I could witness joy, selflessness, and hard work come together for a beautiful night. Thank you, Northfield, for being a place where everyone has a seat at the table and knows they are loved. I can't wait for next year. Susan Whitehurst, a lady who is right over here, who texted me right before we came and said, please don't put my picture on the screen. And I told staff this morning, I said, I'm going to act like I didn't even get that text. Because it is too late. She started as one of our silver ladies. She soon became a member at Northfield. She wrote these words. I know y'all haven't known me long, but something you should know is that I have this huge place in my heart for adults and kids who have special needs. Thank you, thank you, thank you for loving on these kids. And then she mentions, and their caregivers too. Their caregivers are often overlooked and their jobs are 24/7 and often overwhelming to say the least. If you don't know her, she usually sits right down front, first service. Jennifer Tynes has headed up that area for the last 6 years. And I just want to give her a round of applause for a full meal, all the stuff that entire team of people do. She says, what this church family has done over the past 6 years brings tears to my eyes. But last night, I have no words, but the smiles I saw all evening said everything. As I looked around, there was not a person who wasn't blessed. God was surely in this place. I felt him, and I felt his smile. Kim Baker, who was with us from the Gallatin Chamber, she is the executive director of the Gallatin Chamber, and she not only volunteered, but she came for the whole evening. Her husband and son were actually buddies for the evening. She wrote this on her social media page. My face hurts from smiling ear to ear all evening. Night to Shine was literally pure joy on repeat all evening. After I finished my honored guest check-in duties, I stood at the back of the room just taking it all in. 177 honored guests and 600 plus volunteers who shared their time to make Friday a magical evening. Seeing my sweet friend Valerie glow and sparkle in her stunning dress made my night, as did watching Haddon and Ryan dance the night away with their queens for the evening. I felt and I witnessed the love of Jesus tonight, and there's no doubt that everyone else who was at Night to Shine did as well. Jacob Swindell works in our tech booth back there, and I didn't find a picture of him. I was looking all over. He's so in the background. He's one of our young people. He's not been here very long, and he helps with our broadcast audio. He wrote these on his social media page. This year was my first year ever doing anything like this, and what an experience it was. It was so cool to see pretty much, and I loved this line, the entire church coming together to make this event happen. A lot of work and a lot of hours, but man, was it worth it. It's hard to put into words what I was actually thinking and what it was like to watch this go down, but seeing how happy and excited our guests and buddies were, but even the other volunteers, well, it was truly something else. The Lord was in that building last night, and I'm so proud to be part of the church that just so happens to meet in the same building. Haley wrote something that had happened a while ago when we were saving it for today. You're going to see Destiny, and you're going to meet her daughter in just a few moments. Destiny is the mother. She came to one of our shopping events. For those of you who don't know, and for those of you who have prom dresses that you would like to donate, every year we take donations. We set up an entire shop where people can, for about 3 to 4 weeks before the event, they can come shop for dresses, necklaces, rings, earrings, whatever they might need for a prom. It's all donated. It's all free. Well, Destiny, as her daughter was picking out a pink dress, Destiny said these words, "You know, other than my daughter being a flower girl earlier in her life, this is the first time I have been able to watch her dress up for an event. We tried a lot of dresses on, but when we got to the pink dress, wow, did she smile. I could tell that she felt pretty. I never thought I would have this moment, and it is one of the best mom moments I've had in my entire life." And then a last one from a mom. Mary Lee Kerrigan wrote this. The picture on the screen right now is of her daughter, Addie. And she writes about what happened after Night to Shine Friday night. "This night always leaves me without words. Every year you think it's the best night ever, and then the next year, will they make it even more amazing? Thank you to Northfield Church, every single volunteer, and y'all, there were so many of you, especially her buddy for the evening, Matthew Cook, and then what a treat to have Walter Hayes show up, and then I guess to the Tim Tebow Foundation for making this the best night ever. I just want to tell you the conversation that occurred as I was tucking Addie into bed tonight. Addie," this is from Addie, "she's using her hand motions and all of her best facial expressions and eye movements. She said these words, 'Well, that Northfield Church needs to get their act together and get that music going.'" To which her mom said, "Well, I looked at Addie and said, 'Addie, they had music going all night long.'" Kind of like a, you know, a Lionel Richie moment there. And anyway, those I can tell, y'all are younger than I am. Addie comes back with this. "No, they need to get it going until midnight. I wasn't done dancing." That's right. Give her a clap there. And each of you, because of the sacrifice you made, whether it was that evening or whether it's you just give to Northfield Church, really you give to God, you just give through this church here, all of you helped make that happen. I wanted to kind of wrap up our time today, and then as I said, next week we're going to jump back into the Sermon on the Mount. But since so much of the Sermon on the Mount talks about how we treat other people, I thought, wouldn't it be neat to hear from some people who experienced Night to Shine for the first time? So, if you're wondering what the stools are up here for, I'm going to call Marianne Aldedef, Sue Noakes, Andrew Burnett, and John Harris to the stage with me. Give them a warm round of applause for saying yes. How are you doing?
I'm doing.
Hey, second service here. We're going. We're cooking with grease. Hey, I'm going to just ask you for a moment. We'll start over here with you, Sue. Tell the audience, in case they don't know you, how you came to be at Night to Shine.
My name is Sue Noakes, and I have a special needs nephew by the name of Brett, or Brettster as I call him. And Brett wanted to go to the prom, and I wanted him to have the experience, and so I went as his caregiver. He's been with me, living with me now full time for the last month, and I helped birth him, and he lived with me when he was young, so he's very dear to me.
Hey, we've got a picture of Brett dancing on the red carpet there. Let's see if we can play that. Well, let's go.
As you can tell, his buddy was far different than his Aunt Sue. That's a good-looking buddy, isn't it? I don't know who paired him up, but it's not going to be the same at my house.
Hey, you might have to get your red dress to wear around over
evidently,
there.
Evidently, something. Oh, it's going to take plastic work, I think.
Oh. I'll sign up too.
Okay, maybe
we got a picture of Michael up there on the screen. I saw it. I think I got a little bit out of order.
I don't think he realizes how lucky he was, honestly.
Hey, and a big shout out to those five UT cheerleaders who came down to help us on the red carpet there. Tell us a little bit about how you've been here.
Michael is 49 years old. We chose Northfield because of their heart for special needs individuals, and that program has done nothing but make us so, so very happy. And we're glad to be here.
It's an honor to have you here. Andrew, tell us a little bit about how you came to Night to Shine this year.
Yeah, hey guys, good morning family. So I'm Andrew Burnett. I typically am involved in Night to Shine from the tech booth side of things. This year, Brad Schreiner, my good friend, called me and said, hey Andrew, we're short on younger men volunteering as buddies and we need you to step up and be a buddy. And I said, yes ma'am, I'll be there.
She did not. No, that's how we all react to Brad, isn't it? And speaking of younger men, she did not call me for that opportunity. Anyway, we have to talk to her. Hey, and John, your role changed a little bit about this year.
Right. I'm John Harris. Usually you can see me back there in the shadows playing the bass a little bit. But I think this is my third Night to Shine, and Northfield does Night to Shine, so I do what Northfield does. And I've been working with Agape to the Nations in Kinsley for a long time, and when the opportunity arose to go to the Dominican Republic and showcase what we're doing there for that community, I said yes, and here we are.
Well, hey, we're going to back up a little bit. I'm going to start over here with the ladies. And, you know, we showed that picture of Michael with the cheerleaders a while ago. He seems to be loving the setting. I'm going to ask you a deeper question in the moment. But as you saw him all dressed up, and I think I've got a picture of him just dressed up at your house before you left. There it is. What were your initial thoughts, whether it was arriving the evening or him getting ready to go, Marianne?
Well, my initial thought was I was glad that gosh darn tuxedos still fit. He hasn't worn one in 20 years since his sister got married. And of course we killed the tie because nothing goes around that neck. I think I was terrified, actually. I was releasing him to a situation that still in my mind was an unknown. And we'll talk about that more later, but it was with great trepidation that I brought him.
You honestly stood out there on the doorstep and greeted everyone who came in. So you not only had someone that was an honored guest, you worked the night as well.
And boy, was I ever blessed for that. If you have the opportunity to do that in the future, there are no words that describe the looks on their faces as they come in. We had some gentlemen that were probably approaching maybe 70 years of age, and you got the idea that that was probably the absolute best night of their entire lives. And it blew me away. I was a puddle on the floor, and still am when I think about them, still am.
Well, I know, so you got to see a picture of Brett dancing as an aunt, and now with Brett living with you for the last month. What was the evening like, just arriving on the parking lot, and what were the emotions you were feeling?
Well, I found the night to be a cavalcade of emotions. You pull in and you think, wow, right? And then the lights in the front of the building, and then you're lined up to go around, and you see these wonderful people standing out in the parking lot. You knew their faces were frozen, and I yelled at a couple of them I knew, and they came over and gave me their hands, and they were just frozen, just stiff. And I know frozen. I'm from Detroit, and I'm not a wuss. And those guys were smiling through it all, and so then Libby yelled at me and said, here, take him in here. We got to take him in here and register, and I'm parking, and I went in and started sitting in the registration line, and then you had all different emotions there. Like there were a young lady in front of me. I said, my, you look lovely. Well, I tried on 5 dresses yesterday, and this is my favorite. I said, you look gorgeous. So then you're registered, and they're going to hand you off to your buddy. And at that point, I could feel the anxiety in my chest because I just don't give him to anyone. I mean, you know, I run a background check on your DNA before I hand away that kid. So, and then I think it was mother and grandmother that was in front of me, they too, the grandmother looks at me and says, do we have to give him, we get to go with him, don't we? And I said, well, I don't think so. I think they go one way and we go another. So there was that anxiety. And then when they, Leanne took him, who Leanne is, I don't know if she's here, but she was fabulous with him all night long. And then Leanne made me feel like this big because Leanne and her husband both were buddies, and they had been going to Northfield for 2 months. 2 months, and they jumped in and dedicated themselves like that. And I watched her husband too, he was having a ball, and I thought, now I feel awful. I think I went here for 2 years before I did anything. So I felt that emotion, and then I thought, I'm looking in the things because I'm a little anxious still. Saw the makeup, hair and makeup, it was fabulous, and the guys getting their shoes shined. And then I wandered up and stood with Marianne and others as they came in the door. And I am telling you, you go from the joy of seeing, you saw some of them that were so joyful, you saw others, it just broke your heart. I mean, Marianne and I could barely look at each other without crying. And it was just an incredible, incredible evening.
Well, I know, Marianne, you talked about that intrepidation as well. Walk us through what it's like for a mom and, you know, just from your standpoint of that releasing and maybe encouraging some of our parents. What is that like?
Well, I like control. I mean, you know, I'm a mom. I'm not really. I'm a green, but I think I'm kind of bipolar, whatever you call that word.
We have to redo the test, Marianne.
Maybe I'm I might have cheated a little bit, you know. Anyhow, it's not easy to let them go. And I think you think about the world that we live in, and there's a lot of sharp curves, and there's a lot of bullying, and there has been over the years. And then you think about coming to a place where none of that is here. It's nothing but a giant love fest. And so I signed him up. I'm embarrassed to tell you, there were like 90, almost 100 people before I agreed to sign him up. And I thought, well, what's the worst that can happen? Sam and I'll take him home after 20 minutes, you know, it's okay. And we brought him. June and Frank Parker, who were at the first service, prayed for him the whole time leading up to A Night to Shine. Let me tell you, there's something to be said about that, because he talked about it all week long. He was excited about it all week long. When people had asked me prior to that, had he ever gone to A Night to Shine, I said, that's not his thing. You know what? I never asked him. It wasn't mom's thing to let him go. And when you release, when you cut those apron strings, when you quit being the crossing guard, you know, and you let them be, it's a beautiful thing, a beautiful thing. He had a spectacular buddy, Kimberly Wyman, who got him to do things I didn't think were possible, like wear his glasses the whole time and sing Copacabana, which in itself was something, I'm telling you. But the bottom line was, it was God working. He was orchestrating it through all the beautiful volunteers, through Tom, who was a glorious, most unpastor-like pastor I've ever met. It was just meant to be. Yes, it was. It was just meant to be. And if I could sign him up tomorrow for next year, he'd be the first one, because it's not to be missed. It's just not.
I know when I first met you and Sam, we were you were deciding on what was the place for Michael and for you guys. And one of the things you told me at that meeting, you asked me a question. You said, Tom, what do you think, if you're the caregiver or you're the parent of a child who has special needs, what do you think that we think about every waking moment? And of course, I had no clue. And then you said, who's going to get them when I'm gone? Who do I release them to? So what a beautiful moment to have you both, you know, at different times say that that was an angst in your life, a moment. And you too, Sue, same way? I will not ask you to talk anymore because I know your motto is never let them see you sweat. Well, if I transition over here, Andrew, this was your first time to be a buddy. After hearing them talk about the angst they have in letting someone they love go, what was it like for you being on the other end? We've got a picture, we've got a picture of you walking down the aisle, a little video. Let's show them real quick before you talk. They told me that that you even had to have some lessons back there on all the ways to the maneuver a wheelchair. So you had a little bit different view. And hearing them talk and then knowing you're the one that they're releasing into, what was the night like for you as a first-time buddy?
Yeah, Tom. So I think, you know, when you first get started and kind of dive into the night, you're nervous about how it's going to go and who you're going to be paired with as far as your honored guests. But That focus very quickly transitions from inward to them, and just being, very quickly I noticed that it just became an honor to be able to serve her and to host her that evening, and to be able to serve her mom, Destiny, who Tom talked about just a little bit ago. Destiny, her mother was incredible, and Dania was amazing. And the second part of that I'll say is, I feel like I've heard several stories where God intentionally paired specific buddies with honored guests, and I felt like I definitely felt like that was the case with Dania. Like it was just a great match, and her mom even mentioned that, and I followed up some with her since, and it's an incredible honor to serve.
Well, you bring up a point. A lot of Night to Shines, in fact, in the manual that we get, because we get a whole big manual from the Tim Tebow Foundation, it talks about how most of the people, their requirement is that you have the buddies in one room, the dates, and you have the honored guest, and then when you get there, they're matched together, and that's something that happens that night. Brad Schreiner and Lindsay Matlock lead the team here. She was even telling me afterwards that I already knew that they give every honored guest to someone who is praying over them. They pray over that booklet. They look at everything that you would have filled out as a caregiver. They look at the needs there, and then they pray about who God wants them to have on the other end. And Brad was in tears afterwards. She said, you know, to hear that the prayers that you prayed before you even partnered somebody together come true was an emotional moment for her. So I think it is incredible. One of the things that I loved, if they saw in the video, we had this moment where we all did a dance, and it was slide to the left, slide to the right, and everybody's sliding here and sliding there. But your guest was in a wheelchair, your date. What was that like for you? Because I don't think you missed a beat with that wheelchair, sliding this way, that way, and up and back.
I had to step back about 20 years into my younger days. I just wanted to, you know, her mom, and you mentioned this earlier, but Dania was 25, and her mom had only had the opportunity to see her dress up 2 years in her entire life. And you could just tell, I've never seen a smile so genuine from her mom. And Dania, you could even tell, Dania was nonverbal, but you could tell that she felt just a ton of joy in the moment and very comfortable. And even just, she would look back and look up at me to make sure I was still there. And I just wanted her to feel just like she was, just like everybody else in the room in that moment, and not stay towards the back or, you know, kind of just watch from a distance, but wanted to just get her in the middle like everybody else, and that meant the world to her mom.
Well, I think it did to her too, and everyone watching on. So, hey, for my first time guy buddy, and sometimes we have a little bit of harder time getting the guy buddies in there, especially the older ones who aren't teenagers. Teenagers are right there, but sometimes we need a little bit more stuff on the upper end, a little bit more experience in life. So, thank you for answering that call. John, so take us to the Dominican Republic. A lot different than here, wasn't it?
A whole lot different. First off, I was going on this trip with, I think the number was 19 other women. And I knew I'd get that reaction. My friend Shane, he came with me, and then a guy that I met, Mark, he was there too. But it was us three guys and a bunch of ladies, and the apprehension was set before we even got on the airplane, but immediately after getting to know everybody, we had an absolute blast. You were talking about perspective earlier. If you walk out the front door in Northfield, there's a Honda dealership, Taco Bell, big thumbs up for me, Domino's, and million-dollar homes across the street. Across the street from Josiah's house, if you look over the 12-foot barbed wire fence, there's a cinder block framing where they build these houses in stages. So if I have $10,000, I can frame up this structure. Some of this structure had roof over a few of the rooms, and there's a Haitian family squatting there. There's no plumbing, there's no electricity, and they walk down the road every morning. Somebody throws a hose over their compound wall, and they get water, and they wash up. There's two kids, maybe a five-year-old little girl and an eight-year-old son, and a family. And then when the family that owns the property, when they're ready to continue building, they will show up and they say, hey, you guys got to go. They have nowhere to go, and they'll have to find another place. So it's a much different perspective. Everybody always says that unless you see it with your eyes and you smell the smells, that you don't really get it. It's a very cliche thing to say, but it's absolutely true. It's very different looking at this really cool high-end production that Northfield puts on here. And then we're back in the Dominican Republic, and the tents are flying away because we have 15-mile-per-hour wind gusts. All the plastic chairs are blown all over the place. We have broken lights all over the place. The red carpet can't even stay down. We had to go get rocks out of this construction site to keep the red carpet down from blowing away. But the guests never knew that. They got there like an hour and a half earlier. 10 people showed up that weren't even on the list. Some of these people drove over 3 hours just to come here. And unless we do it again, they'll probably never have that kind of an experience.
Well, hey, I'm down. Are we down to make it happen there again? We got time for maybe just a couple of pictures. Put that first one up there of your red carpet. In spite of all of that, look at that. Isn't that beautiful? I can't tell that anything is missing or even out of place there. Tell us about Teo and then...
Right, so this is Teo. We would have never gone to the Dominican Republic to do Night to Shine if it wasn't for him. Teo lives at Josiah's house. This is where the property is. The only thing that we know about Teo is that he lived in a sugarcane village down the road, and the staff at Hope Continues in Josiah's house heard about him, and he was basically treated like a stray dog. They would, throw food scraps out to him, and then he would get scared, and he'd run back off into the sugarcane, and then they were able to go get him. They gave him the name Teo. They know nothing about him. They don't know where his parents are, if they're alive. Does he have family? Where are they from? They don't know anything about him. He's completely nonverbal, and they've been taking care of him for a few years, and he'll probably be there for the rest of his life.
Well, amazing. For the sake of time, being there in the midst of all those women did have an influence on you. Show the last picture there, the red carpet. Thank you for sending that.
To provide some clarity, that was a joke. I sent that to Tom in thinking that he might need a picture of me on his wall in his office. And now all of you guys saw it. So that was my best side.
Hey, Andrew, if you had one thing to say in parting, what would that be?
Yeah, I would just say for anybody who has not served at Night to Shine before, or if you have not been a buddy before, it is stretching, and it is something that you have to step out of your comfort zone. And I would just say don't be afraid to give your yes and to step out and serve. Anything that makes you uncomfortable is typically growing, and that's where you can serve the most. So I would love to see you there next year.
Thank you. Marianne? one last whatever to volunteers or just your thoughts.
Well, the volunteers we can't say enough about. I mean, and it's selfish because you get so much back. I mean, what you may give is minuscule compared to what comes back to you. I must have had half a dozen hugs that night that will just carry me through whatever because they were so particularly genuine. Don't be afraid to let your loved ones experience things. Don't be afraid. And don't be afraid yourself to jump in and answer that call because you will be blessed. And we can't thank you enough. We really can't.
So,
I would start with a grateful heart. I can't tell you how we could ever repay all of you for what you've done. It starts with you. And you, as our leader, I'm going to suck it up, Tom, as our leader pointing in that us in that direction for 6 years, leading us and continuing to lead us to do God's work and love people and make Jesus known. And you certainly have done this through this and Haley and all of your staff that have put in months and months of time. And then to all those 680 plus people who served and gave of themselves, you know, in Matthew 5:16 it says, let your light so shine so others may see his good works, and you certainly did that. And in this upside down kingdom, I think it's the best example of people doing the right thing for the right reasons and not to be seen. All those people that were freezing in the parking lot and freezing in the line, and Marianne and I, who were standing inside the door, not as freezing, and watching all of this go on for some people that we loved, it's just incredibly, incredibly overwhelming. So thank you for being the community that you are and continuing to serve in the way I think he wants us to serve. And if God can skip, I'm sure he's skipping today.
Thank each of you. I know. Let me wrap up a little bit. It took so much to make Night to Shine happen. We have three of our college kids, Mackenzie Longmire, Samantha Tynes, and Noah Blackwell, who flew in or drove in from other states to be here that evening. A picture on the screen there, just a wonderful man. His name is Christian. I got to meet him. His dad is back there behind him. His dad said these words: this is not a church. This is an army. It's an army. Rick Warren, in his book, Purpose Driven Church, in the very first chapter, wrote these words, that the church was an army, and if she were ever awakened, wow, what a difference we could make in our world. Let me read you one other message. We'll close. It actually, I saw it from my daughter online on her social media account. She began by quoting Bob Goff: I used to think you had to be special for God to use you, but now I know you simply need to say yes. Looking back on this weekend, I'm reminded of how grateful I am to be a part of a church who have said yes to Night to Shine for 6 years now. It is by far one of my favorite nights of the year, and it's not because of the fancy lights or all the decorations and flowers and balloons, but because this night is such an example of how to love people well. Over the course of the last 6 years, we have watched as over 800 honored guests made their way down the red carpet, danced the night away, and then were crowned the king and the queen that they have always been. I will forever be grateful to play just my small part in this night every year. I'm grateful to see our church family and people from the community come together. I've heard Dad teach about the great commandment where Jesus says to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. You will love your neighbor like you love yourself. To me, Night to Shine is what that looks like. If you saw Channel 2 News, they did come and they ask a lot of questions. And have you ever been asked a question and on the spur of the moment, you get away from there and you don't even know what you said and you're hoping? I think, well, I hope it sounded pretty good. And the question they asked was, why do you do it? Why do you do it? Why do you go to the karaoke room and just sing the night away? Why do you do all those things? Well, in my more calm moments, as I was driving off of campus somewhere close to midnight Friday night, the Christmas story came to mind. And I thought of all things the Christmas story. And when I really begin to think about it, the Christmas story is really just God showing up, isn't it? That we had this moment in time where God just showed up on planet Earth. And who did he show up to? Oh, my heavens, the most unlikely of characters, some shepherds out in the field that had been left behind, or a young teenage couple who were trying to figure out this God in me type of moment. And for a moment, I realized that we have a chance every day of our lives to live incarnationally, to relive this God in us moment. And maybe the best things we can do in our lives is just every day make the world our Christmas story, where we just begin as the people and the men and women and the children of God show up in people's lives in a meaningful way that matters. Next week, we're going to dive back into the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus prays, Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Maybe that's what happened Friday night. I love you guys. Have an awesome week.